Prophet Muhammad has been known for igniting passion and love amongst Muslims across the globe. He was believed to have moved millions of men, ideas, beliefs, and values, and continues to do so up until this day. A prophet deemed a prophet for all mankind. Having been sent the message of Allah's holy book, he holds great significance within the religion of Islam. A man known to have changed the course of history. The aim of his message was to provide a religion which serves to maintain peace and logic within all of humanity.
Plane crash into the World Trade Center here at the lower tip of Manhattan.
We're also getting reports this morning of an explosion, a bomb explosion in Russell Square.
Police said there were 5 explosions caused by homemade devices in 2 areas of the capital, Manamah, earlier today.
Sees now a surprising twist in Libya today. A crowd actually drove an Islamist militia out of Benghazi in an apparent show.
Government have clamped down on free speech and public gatherings, prompting condemnation from human rights groups.
25 Chicago Transit Authority buses that have started rolling out across the city. They're sporting the new ad campaign. You'll see these rolling billboards everywhere with everyday people talking about their own personal jihad, which, as it turns out, has a very different meaning to Muslims.
Jihad in Islam simply means to struggle. Jihad in Islam simply means to struggle to a better place. So whatever barriers or burdens or shortcomings that you have in your life, you are asked, you're tasked to muster in the inner courage, the inner strength, the inner resolve, the inner determination to overcome those personal barriers.
The Holy Quran, the Prophet, and his teachings have all sparked uproar across Western civilization. War, jihad, terrorism, religious intolerance, these are all phrases most frequently associated with Islam. The chaos spreading around the world appears to be pointing towards one direction. And this has been depicted through various anti-Islam advertisements, movies, documentaries, where violence seems to be a common theme, despite the teachings of the Holy Quran and the characteristics of the Prophet. The question that many fail to ask is, why do these characteristics get ignored? Those that promote peace, kindness, and justice. This documentary aims to address these issues and the widespread misconceptions associated with Islam. Starting with the concept of jihad, why it's used, what it means, and how it is presented in society today.
The concept of jihad, the first thing we need to understand about it is that this is a notion and a concept that has been misrepresented by the propaganda campaign that we see going around. And there's a lot of literature on this, non-Muslim literature on this, and it's surprising to see that if you do a search on Google about jihad, you find the number of hits is sometimes even greater than the number of hits that you'll find for entire religions.
In Arabic, yujahid, or jahada, as a verb, it's a huge, enormous meaning. It means I can struggle with my own desires. I can struggle with my own weaknesses. I can struggle with the temptations I face in life. So how dare you hijacking a concept to fit a very, very narrow understanding and impose it on me? Where are the Muslims who would correct the concept of jihad and say the greatest use of the word jihad in Islam and even in Christianity is a jihad. To struggle against your own weaknesses and against your own shortfalls.
من المفردات التي جاء بها الإسلام مفردة الجهاد. والجهاد لها مدلول لغوي في لغة العرب ولها مدلول اصطلاحي فقهي. أما المدلول اللغوي لمفردة الجهاد فهي من بذل الجهد والوسع والطاقة وإعطاء الإنسان طاقته ووسعه من حيث العمل، من حيث ما يقوم به الإنسان من عملية بدنية أو فكرية يسمى جهاد.
Some Muslims have misinterpreted and misrepresented the concept of jihad. They have tried to use it for their own political aims and objectives. And this is an unfortunate reality, but I think it's very important for Muslims and non-Muslims both to make that distinction, that we find as human beings, we have it in our nature that if we do not bring our animalistic and our selfish desires under control, we are capable of bloodshed and we are capable of killing. And so the aim of Islam was to purify humanity of these vile and these base and these evil intentions. But it's unfortunate to see that they have done the opposite. They've used a concept like this to justify the insane and mindless killing of innocent civilians. But the Islamic concept of jihad has nothing to do with that. Jihad was meant to be a tool for defending justice, for protecting civilians from foreign invasions. It was simply a measure to guarantee the defense of life and property in the city of Medina. And historically, it was used for those purposes. And so I think even as non-Muslims, they need to appreciate this reality, that when people engage in killing, when they engage in bloodshed, it's not because of, you know, people reading the Quran and seeing that the Quran orders them to do this. Rather, human beings, as one journalist put it, he said, human beings kill not because religion instructs them to kill. Human beings kill because they are human beings.
The word jihad, which is an Arabic word, also has been hijacked by some people. And now it's even a negative word. They say those jihadists, and it's extremely negative adjective in Islam, which is very sad, because if you understand the context again about jihad, in Arabic, yujahid or jahada as a verb, it's a huge, enormous meaning.
الإسلام جعل من الجهاد كلمة تبتدئ بالعقيدة والفكر والعطاء وتكوين الأسرة والأمر بالمعروف والنهي عن المنكر وكل ذلك يسمى جهادا في الإسلام ولا يقتصر بمفردته على مسألة القتال أو الحرب أو إشهار السيف لذلك نلاحظ أن الثقافة الإسلامية تطلق الجهاد الأكبر والجهاد الأصغر والجهاد الأكبر هو الأساس الذي إذا لم يحسنه الإنسان لا يستطيع أن يأتي بالجهاد الأصغر وهو القتال الجهاد الأكبر هو جهاد النفس هو محاربة الهوى والجهاد الأصغر هو جهاد القتال لذلك إذا قرأنا في القرآن الكريم وفي الثقافة الإسلامية نلاحظ تعدد موارد استعمال الجهاد.
Once Mahatma Gandhi said to the Christians, "Give me your Christ and take your Christianity." In every religion in the world, the founder of the religion and the religion grow not very closely. So by time, always, in any religion in the world, religion drifts a bit far from the founder. In Christianity it happened, in Judaism it happened, and in Islam it happened. I wish Muslims are like Islam, intended to be by the Prophet.
مما يؤسف له بأن الكثير من المفاهيم الإسلامية الرائعة في محتواها والعظيمة في مضامينها قد حولت وقد تبدلت في مفاهيمها إلى مفاهيم أخرى وأحيانا تعاكس المفاهيم الأساسية التي انطلقت. لدينا اليوم أزمة معرفة وأزمة ثقافة. هذه الأزمة تنطبق على أغلب مفاهيم الإسلام. مفهوم الجهاد من هذه المفاهيم التي تبدلت وتغيرت عن منحاها الأساسي الذي اختطه الله في قرآنه والذي اختطه رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم في سيرته وأهل البيت في تعاليمهم وفي حركاتهم. طيب، إذن لابد من أن نستجلي هذا المفهوم. اليوم الأغلب من المسلمين للأسف لا يفهمون من الجهاد سوى القتل، ولا يفهمون من الجهاد سوى السيف، ولا يفهمون من الجهاد سوى أن يدخل الإنسان في سوح الوغى، وهذا أقل عناصر الجهاد وموارده. ومن هنا للأسف انعكس هذا المفهوم السلبي، انعكس على تصور غير المسلمين لمفهوم الجهاد، فأصبح غير المسلمين من الغرب ويتصورون الجهاد بأنه قتل وإراقة للدماء ونهب وسلب ودمار وتخريب، كما للأسف نلاحظه اليوم في أغلب البقاع التي يدعون أنهم يجاهدون فيها، ولكنهم أصبحوا في قعر الشيطان ومن حبائل الشيطان، وهذا بعيد عن الإسلام كل البعد. المراد من اليد هو أن يستطيع الإنسان أن يغير بقوته تغييرا، إما من حيث الثقافة، إما من حيث الإرشاد، إما من حيث أن يأتي إلى المنكر. لاحظوا، من رأى منكرا.
We all wish, I'm sure even Muslims wish, that their lives and their way of living the faith is like what was intended to be by the Prophet. There is no religion which is identical the way of life in the life of the people of that religion, identical to the teachings of the religion. So we all struggle to live, and we all struggle to apply the teachings in our lives.
When the Holy Prophet conducted war at his time, he always was very careful to instruct his soldiers and the people who would take part in the war. He would give them instructions. And today, what certain Muslim groups and those that engage in violence, they're certainly not observing those laws. Because the laws and instructions that the Prophet would give his soldiers, those laws were designed to ensure that the sanctity of life was respected. So the Prophet of Allah would always instruct the soldiers that you do not kill any non-combatants, you do not kill civilians, you only fight those who come to fight you in the battlefield. And that was the instruction of the Quran, that قَاتِلُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ الَّذِينَ يُقَاتِلُونَكُمْ. You fight in the way of God against those who fight against you. So civilians, non-combatants, women, children, these were not to be touched. Worshippers who were worshipping in their places of worship, their places of worship were to be respected. Trees were not to be uprooted. Imagine, not only human life was regarded as something having sanctity, even plant life was to be respected. So the Prophet would give these kinds of commands and these kinds of instructions to his armies, the kind of mindless and senseless killing that we see today.
One war, I remember, took 70 years to end. By the end of that war, nobody remembered why it started. And then the war's name is Dahis wal-Ghabra. And the speculations are that this war started because of a dispute over two horses. That was the situation before the Prophet. Bloodshed, wars everywhere, and the Prophet came with the vision to unite these tribes and provided them with a system. And the system worked.
قرأنا التاريخ الإسلامي المجمع عليه بين المسلمين وحتى من أرخ من المستشرقين نلاحظ بأن الحروب التي خاضها رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم كانت مفروضة على النبي وهذا تاريخ يثبته يعني لم يكن الرسول صلوات الله وسلامه عليه يبتدئ بالحرب أبدا وإنما جاءته الأخبار إما من السماء وإما خبر هذا وذاك بأن فلان قبيلة تعد للحرب ضد رسول الله أو الجيش الفلاني تهيأ وتقدم إلى المدينة المنورة فكان يخرج إليهم رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم والذي يؤكد بأن الرسول صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم لم يكن داعية حرب هو عدد الضحايا التي خلفتها المعارك التي قادها رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم عدد الضحايا من الطرفين من المسلمين ومن الكفار الذين جاءوا للقضاء على الإسلام بزعمهم كل ذلك لم يتجاوز 1000 شخص هذا باحتساب 600 من يهود بني قريظة ويشكك البعض في صحة قضية يهود بني قريظة فإذا استثنينا يهود بني قريظة يكون العدد 400 شخص فقط الذين قتلوا في الحروب التي خاضها رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم الحروب الدفاعية عن الإسلام الدفاعية وهذا حق الدفاع العام يضمنه وتضمنه حقوق البشر التي تقوم اليوم في الدنيا ويجب عليكم كمثقفين وإعلاميين ووعاة ويجب على كل قطاعات العالم الإسلامي من شباب وكهول ومثقفين وعلماء وإعلاميين وصحفيين ومتحدثين أن يبينوا هذه النقطة للعالم بأسره بأن الجهاد لم يكن ليعني القتل والقتال فحسب أبدا
But we have to work together. We have to clarify these things and say stop to those people who are trying to abuse these concepts and put them in frameworks that we can't touch. No, we have to touch and we have to break these frameworks and liberate these concepts to mean what they really mean.
ويتصورون الجهاد بأنه قتل وإراقة للدماء ونهب وسلب ودمار وتخريب كما للأسف نلاحظه اليوم في أغلب البقاع التي يدعون أنهم يجاهدون فيها ولكنهم أصبحوا في قعر الشيطان ومن حبائل الشيطان وهذا بعيد عن الإسلام كل البعد
Many have the impression that Islam is a religion that is driven by extremism and force. The violent reaction of some people who have taken Islamic teachings to different contexts has caught the attention of many, promoting the idea that Islam is an intolerant religion by spreading its message through the sword.
Islam is tolerant and is welcoming and open to the other. What is not very clear and strong is how. How? It's not, I'm sorry, you cannot tell me you are tolerant because you have some interfaith activities and some conferences and some, I don't know what, lectures. And tolerance is not enough. I do believe with all my heart that when it comes to relationships, human relationships, tolerant is not enough. I don't want to live with you only on the level of I put up with you. What is tolerance? If you go to the dictionary, it is putting up with. Is this all what we want? To put up with each other? We want to build strong relationships. We want to build partnerships in life. We want to build bridges that all people can cross. We don't want just to tolerate each other, which is the minimum, lowest common denominator. This is not enough, because this is fragile.
لا إكراه في الدين. There is no compulsion in religion. قد تبين الرشد من الغي. The reason why there is no compulsion in the religion of Islam is because Islam is a very logical and a very rational religion. Truth and falsehood are distinct from each other. If they were not distinct, maybe then you would have to force people. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying this is such a rational religion, it appeals to the intellect, you don't need to force people. So the principle that was given was la ikraha fid din. There is no compulsion in religion. The Prophet advised these parents, he said, you just present to them the teachings of Islam. If it appeals to them, give them the freedom to accept it. If it doesn't appeal to them and they don't want to accept it, they want to continue with their old lifestyle, give them the freedom to that, because la ikraha fid din is the principle. There is no compulsion in religions.
You know, ignorance breeds fear. And fear breeds violence. When we are ignorant about each other, that breeds enormous amount of fear. And that fear produces hostility. And that's what we should target, ignorance. And we target ignorance by raising the awareness of the people to their own faith, the values of their own faith, and then get to know the other.
That as Muslims, whenever we hear Islam or the Prophet or anything Islamic being criticized, or we have events like the cartoons that you referred to, or any other film or documentary is released insulting the Prophet or insulting personalities whom we consider to be sacred, our response is very much, it's un-Islamic, it's un-Quranic. And I think that's the tragedy today, that even though we claim to be Muslims, we are not connected to the Book of Allah. And our response is not guided and governed by that which Allah has revealed in His book. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has warned us. He has given us the heads up that if you walk on the path of truth, you will face a lot of criticism. People will try to provoke you. People will try to test your patience. They will push your buttons. And that's why in Surah Ali Imran, Surah number 3 of the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us of this, and He also gives us His solution. The problem is because as Muslims, many Muslims don't even take the time to read the Quran and to ponder over what Allah has revealed in it, our response is not guided by what Allah has revealed in it. But what does Allah tell us in the Quran? He says, لَتُبْلَوُنَّ فِي أَمْوَالِكُمْ وَأَنفُسِكُمْ. Allah says, if you walk on my path, you will be tested in terms of your life and in terms of your wealth. We will test you in all areas. And then look at what he says. He says, وَلَتَسْمَعُنَّ مِنَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ وَمِنَ الَّذِينَ أَشْرَكُوا أَذًا كَثِيرًا. Allah says, you will have to hear a lot of hurtful things from those who were given the book before you, from the Ahlul Kitab, and also from the Mushrikeen.
The internet is an uncontrolled space. That is a fact. So if we respond to everything appears on the internet in the way that Muslims behaved after the film against the Islam and the Prophet appeared, then it would be a disaster. I think the reaction of the Muslims was totally out of proportion and should not have happened.
We're told in the narration of the Sirah that there used to be a Jewish woman who on a daily basis, she would throw garbage at the Prophet. And she would try to disrespect him in that manner. How did the Prophet treat her? Did he show any violence or did he use force against her? No. The Prophet used to pass. She used to throw that garbage on him every day and he used to patiently take it. One day, she didn't come out of the balcony to throw that garbage on her. So the Prophet inquires about her. And he's told that she has fallen sick. So he actually goes to visit her. And when he comes by her bedside, she's shocked to see him. She thinks that now I'm sick. He probably might, you know, decide to take some kind of revenge against me. She asks him, why have you come? And he says, I've simply come to inquire about your health, about your well-being. If there is anything that I can do for you, let me know. When someone does something evil, obviously when they're attacking Islam or insulting our symbols, they're doing something evil. But what does Allah ask us to do? Does He ask us to respond to their evil with an evil of our own? No. Allah says, idfa billati hiya ahsan. Repel evil with that which is best. Repel evil with goodness. Because if you do that, what happens is, what happened in the case of the Prophet. That فَإِذَا الَّذِي بَيْنَكَ وَبَيْنَهُ عَدَاوَةٌ كَأَنَّهُ وَلِيٌّ حَمِيمٌ. Allah says, if you make this your habit, if you make this your practice, that you repel evil with goodness, most of the time your greatest enemy will become your closest friend. Because kindness has the potential to move the human hearts. And it can transform and melt even the hardest of hearts. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that I do not forbid you in the case of those unbelievers who neither fought against you because of your religion and who neither drove you away from your homes simply because of the fact that you are Muslim. Those unbelievers who did not do these things, Allah does not forbid you. He does not prevent you from showing kindness and love and mercy and justice to these people. In fact, Allah encourages you to be nice to them, to be good to them, and to show them love, mercy, and justice. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُقْسِطِينَ. Allah loves those who are just. And then in verse number 9, he then gives us the principle. All the verses in the Quran that sound seemingly harsh or that instruct the Muslims to, you know, fight or to even to kill, Allah in this verse he clarifies who am I talking about. I'm not talking about all unbelievers. He says, إِنَّمَا يَنْهَاكُمُ اللَّهُ عَنِ الَّذِينَ قَاتَلُوكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ وَأَخْرَجُوكُمْ مِنْ دِيَارِكُمْ وَظَاهَرُوا عَلَىٰ إِخْرَاجِكُمْ أَنْ تَوَلَّوهُمْ.
وهنالك آيات قرآنية أخرى تبين أن الإسلام جعل المعتقد حرا للآخرين، قوله تعالى بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم لست عليهم بمسيطر، وقوله بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم فإن أعرضوا فما أرسلناك عليهم حفيظا، يعني أنت عليك البلاغ، وإذا أعرض من أعرض فما أرسلناك عليهم حفيظا. هذا يدل بكل وضوح على أن الإسلام لم يقوم بحد السيف. وهكذا قد يستعمل الجهاد باللسان أو قول الحقيقة. لذلك الله تبارك وتعالى يقول بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ادعو إلى سبيل ربك بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة وجادلهم بالتي هي أحسن. هذا الجهاد.
If we truly examine the historical background of the Prophet, we look at the seerah, we look at the biography of the Prophet, we will see that Islam was never spread by the sword. The sword was only used in defense. When Muslims were attacked in Medina, as I mentioned earlier, all the battles took place near Medina. The Meccans would come all the way from Mecca, they would cross the desert, and they would try to come to Medina with the aim of wiping out the Muslim community. It, obviously, One could not have expected that the Prophet would simply receive the Meccans who were coming to attack him with roses or with garlands. He had to do something to defend his community in Medina, and that community was not only composed of Muslims. He was fighting in defense of the Muslims and in defense of the Jews and Christians and non-Muslims who were living in Medina as well. So the Prophet had to do that. But when you look at the method of the Prophet and the methodology of his preaching, it was Islam was spread by the strength and power of the Prophet's character, his akhlaq. That was what drew people to Islam. So one of the accusations that has been made against the seerah of the Prophet is that he massacred certain Jews in Medina, or that he ordered their killing. We need to understand the whole historical background. When the Holy Prophet came in Medina, as we mentioned, he signed a constitution and a covenant with all the religious groups, and that constitution guaranteed that all the different religious groups would be allowed to practice their religion freely. But later on, there were certain elements within the Jewish community who began to violate the provisions of that constitution. So you find one of the provisions of that constitution was that the people of Medina would live together as one community, and if Medina was ever attacked, they would all contribute to the defense of the city of Medina, and no one would ever take part in an act of treason. That is, the people living in Medina would not support any foreign element that would try to invade the city of Medina. But you find in the Battle of Uhud, and especially in the Battle of Khandaq, the Battle of Ahzab, the tribes of Banu Nadir and Banu Qurayza, they broke and they violated this provision. So in the Battle of Uhud, you find the Banu Nadir, they gave intelligence to Abu Sufyan, to the Meccans, and they committed this act of treachery against the Prophet. They even harbored and sheltered some of the soldiers that had come to fight against the Prophet. So obviously, when the Holy Prophet learned of this, he had to take action against them. And so as a deterrent measure, he did not kill anyone. He simply expelled the Banu Nadir from the city of Medina. And then you had the Battle of Ahzab. The Battle of Ahzab, Abu Sufyan brought an army of 10,000 soldiers. And this time they came to Medina with the aim of wiping out the entire Muslim community in Medina. But we find in the books of history that the Holy Prophet dug a trench around the city of Medina to protect the city. But in spite of that, the Banu Qurayza, these Jews, they were approached by the Banu Nadir. The Banu Nadir had been expelled from Medina. They came to the leaders of Banu Qurayza and they said, you know what, there is this planning that Abu Sufyan and the Meccans have made. They want to destroy the Muslims completely, once and for all. We need your support because you are the insiders. We need intelligence, we need your support, we need your cooperation. The Banu Qurayza, their leaders at first, they were hesitant. They turned to the Banu Nadir and they said, look, we have signed, just as you had signed a covenant with the Prophet, we're also signatories to the Constitution of Medina, and the Constitution of Medina forbids us from cooperating with the enemies. We cannot do that. But the Banu Nadir said, look, this is a matter of national concern for us, because this is one opportunity that we have to eliminate the Muslims from Medina. So you need to support us and you need to work with us to destroy and eliminate the Muslims. We need your support. Somehow they were able to convince the Jews of Banu Qurayza, and the Jews of Banu Qurayza, they supported. They gave all kinds of support, military and tactical and intelligence-based reports. They kept on sharing that with Abu Sufyan. But the plan of Abu Sufyan was defeated, and the Kuffar and the Mushrikeen, they lost the battle and they returned to Makkah. After that, this was brought to the attention of the Prophet that the Banu Qurayza had acted with treason, they had acted with treachery. So the Prophet went and confronted them. When he went to confront them, they closed themselves up in their fort and they refused to surrender. Finally, a siege was laid, and later on they agreed to surrender on one condition. And this was the mistake that they made. They said, we're going to surrender and make peace on one condition, that the one who is going to, obviously, they were guilty of treason. So what they were fearful of was that if they surrendered themselves to the Prophet might deal with them harshly. So in order to avoid that, they said, we are going to surrender on one condition, and that is that Sa'd bin Mu'adh should be made the arbiter. He should be the judge of what should happen to us. The reason they did that was they thought Sa'd bin Mu'adh was an ally during the period of Jahiliyyah, because he was from the tribe of Aus. The Aus and the Banu Qurayza, they used to be close allies. So they thought that because he was from a tribe that was allied to them, he would give them a lenient verdict. They did not estimate the Prophet correctly. They thought that he would not deal mercifully with them. And that's why they made Sa'd bin Mu'adh the judge. But that was an unfortunate thing. And that was a critical mistake that they made. Sa'd bin Mu'adh had been injured in the battle. And that's why after the battle, he even met Shahada. He passed away. So obviously, in that state, he was not in a position to really show mercy to a people who had caused so much suffering to the people of Medina. And that's why when Sa'ad was made the judge, the Prophet accepted their condition. Sa'ad bin Mu'adh was made the judge. And Sa'ad bin Mu'adh told the Jews, he said, look, you committed an act of treason and treachery. We're going to judge you by your own book. So he essentially gave them a dose of their own medicine. The Torah had a very tough law on treachery. And it's even there today. If you look at the Old Testament, the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 20, verses 10 to 14, the Bible gives the command on how you deal with people who commit treason or treachery. So it clearly says that if you lay siege to a city and then the people surrender, then you are to put all men to the sword, meaning you slaughter all the men, you take all the women as captives, and everything else comes under your possession. So Sa'd bin Mu'adh gave this verdict, but even then, not all the people were killed. The Sirah of Ibn Ishaq says that 960 Jews were killed. But many other Muslim historians have said that that is actually not true. It was only the heads of the tribes who were killed. The chief leaders who actually took part in those negotiations and who actually committed the acts of treachery with Abu Sufyan and with the Meccans, those were the ones who were killed, not the entire Banu Qurayza. The rest of them were expelled. But the critical mistake that they made was that instead of making the Prophet their judge, they made Sa'd bin Mu'adh. They thought they would get a more lenient verdict from Sa'd bin Mu'adh. But actually, if they had looked at the seerah of the Prophet, they should have made the Prophet their judge. Because the Prophet's policy was, even for an act of treason, look at what he did with the Banu Nadir. He didn't kill them. He simply expelled them from the city of Medina. The Banu Qaynuqa, he did not kill them. He expelled them from the city of Medina. So the Prophet's policy was not of execution, it was of expulsion.
Only reacting violently against things happening around the world. Show me your values. Show me your the values of your founder. And capture my imagination, not by force, and not by imposing yourself on me, but by showing me something to attract me. This is what is, at the moment, requested from Islam.
كيف يمكن أن نتصور هذا المبدأ المغلوط مع الشعار العظيم الذي يرفعه الإسلام قائلا بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم لا إكراه في الدين؟ أين أولئك الذين يتصورون بل يعتقدون وعلى ضوء ذلك يسيرون بأن الإسلام أمر أن تنشر تعاليمه بالسيف؟ أين لا إكراه في الدين؟ هل قرأوا هذه الآية؟ أم طووا عنها كشحة؟
Now in Islam, similar things are happening. The difference between Christianity and Islam, Islam has in its essence the tendency for the marriage between the spiritual agenda and the political agenda. And once politics is there, the possibility of abusing that is higher. Because of that, Islam is more vulnerable to the abuse. So there are verses, hard verses and difficult verses in the Quran. And if we prevent any possibility of understanding the context of these verses, why they came, why they are there. When we don't explain that and we put them in the right context, we give the opportunity for some people to cut these verses and use them in isolation to the bigger context in the Quran. And always the excuse for that is, well, the whole Quran is from Allah. So how can you say this verse is not from Allah? Well, if you believe the whole Quran is from Allah, you must understand that every verse has a context. So as long as you understand the verse in its context, that's fine. But if you take it out of context and use it, then it's a disaster. There are verses in the Bible. Also, we have to understand them within their own context. And if we cut them and take them out, we can easily misunderstand them.
الإسلام لا يعترف ولا يقر بالقتل على الإطلاق وإنما يقول كما عرضت بخدمتكم سابقا فمن اعتدى عليكم فاعتدوا عليه بمثله. لاحظوا تلك الآية تفسر هذه الآية فاعتدوا عليه بمثل ما اعتدى. الآن احنا نلاحظ نقف عند كلمة بمثله. فإذا كان الطرف يهدد البشر من حيث القتل هذا هو الذي لازم أن يقاتل. أما إذا ما كان يهدد البشر من حيث القتل يهدده من حيث الكلام الفاسد نحن نجاوب عليه بكلام نرفع فساده. إذن هذه الآية لابد أن نلاحظ قبلها ونلاحظ بعدها ونلاحظ أن الإسلام كيف انتشر. انتشر الإسلام بالسلم وبالسلام وبالأمن ولا يكون مدخلي على الإطلاق للسيف في نشر الإسلام.
Look at the verse itself. وَاقْتُلُوهُمْ حَيْثُ ثَقِفْتُمُهُمْ. It says kill them or slay them wherever you find them. The first question that any person with common sense needs to ask is اُقْتُلُوهُمْ, that hum, them, that's a pronoun. A pronoun always refers to a noun. So when the Quran says kill them wherever you find them, who is the Quran referring to? What anti-Islamic propagandists or what certain violent Muslim propagandists, what they try to project is that the them, this pronoun, refers to non-Muslims or unbelievers in general. And this is the misconception and the misinterpretation that they try to promote. But the reality is we need to return to the Quranic text and see that them, this them, who does it refer to? When we turn to the Quranic text, we find this is verse number 191 of Surah Al-Baqarah, Surah number 2, as I said. Look at the verse before that. They never quote that verse. And the reason why they do not quote that verse is because they are obviously intellectually dishonest. They realize that if they quote this verse along with the verse that comes before it, then everything makes sense. That you fight against those who come to fight against you. This is a very natural principle. There is nothing out of the ordinary. The Quran is not telling anything to the Muslims that human nature doesn't dictate. It's a normal principle of human nature that self-preservation and self-defense is the first law of nature.
Every religion, because it is a spiritual subject and a spiritual side of life, can be abused. And in the Middle Ages, the church abused Christianity and used some verses from the Bible. But the more and more we educate ourselves and educate our people that we should not isolate verses, we don't deny their existence first. There are some tough and difficult verses in the Quran, as every religion has in the scriptures, in the holy scriptures. No scriptures are easy. But the more we are educated about these scriptures and understand the context and are not afraid to criticize in the very positive way, in a very academic, intellectual, social, economic, geopolitical understanding of the text.
واليوم بعض أعداء الإسلام من الغربيين يطرحون الإسلام بأنه همجي، بأنه يريد أن ينشر ثقافة الحرب وثقافة الاصطدام وثقافة القتل من خلال نشر هذه الآيات. ونحن قد بينا من خلال آيات قرآنية مباركة تدعو إلى السلم وتدعو إلى السلام، تدعو إلى السلم كافة لدى البشرية. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. فإذا انسلخ الأشهر الحرم فقاتلوا المشركين حيث وجدتموهم إلى آخره. هذه الآية واردة في سياق المشرك المحارب.
There is a verse in St. Paul says, let women be silent in the church. If you take that, then no woman should speak in the church. But if you look in the context of why Paul, St. Paul, said this in the Bible, you see that he was talking about a specific problem to that church he was talking to. He was not giving a universal truth that women should be silent. But some people, they cut it and take it out of context and say, you can't speak. And that was used to prevent the ordination of women to the priesthood in Christianity.
He says, إِنَّمَا يَنْهَاكُمُ اللَّهُ عَنِ الَّذِينَ قَاتَلُوكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ وَأَخْرَجُوكُمْ مِنْ دِيَارِكُمْ وَظَاهَرُوا عَلَىٰ إِخْرَاجِكُمْ أَنْ تَوَلَّوْهُمْ وَمَنْ يَتَوَلَّهُمْ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الظَّالِمُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only asks you to be tough. He asks you to be harsh on those unbelievers who drove you out of your homes simply because you are Muslim, who persecuted you and subjected you to unimaginable torture simply because you are Muslim, simply because you wanted to practice your faith, and those who drove you out of your homes, and those who came to fight against you. These are the unbelievers. All those verses that talk about killing, fighting, struggling, those verses are for those unbelievers who actually came all the way from Mecca to destroy the Muslim community in Medina.
أليس ذلك يتناقض مع ما جعله الإسلام من أن الإيمان مرتبط ارتباطا وثيقا بالإنسان نفسه بمشيئة الإنسان وعدم مشيئته؟ الإيمان مرتبط باقتناع الإنسان وعدم قناعته. لذلك الله تبارك وتعالى يقول بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم فمن شاء فليؤمن ومن شاء فليكفر. وهل هنالك آية بهذا الوضوح تبين أن الإنسان مخير في اختيار الإسلام أو غير الإسلام؟ فإذا كان الإسلام كما يتصور هؤلاء السذج قام بحد السيف، يعني أجبر الآخرين على ماذا؟ على قبوله، وهذا لا يقبله الإسلام. الإسلام لا يريد إنسان يؤمن به فقط بماذا؟ باللسان. يريد إنسان يؤمن به بماذا؟ بقلبه. يريد إنسان يعتقد بصحة الإسلام بقلبه، والاعتقاد القلبي لا يقوم بالسيف. قال الله تبارك وتعالى مخاطبا النبي بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أفأنت تكره الناس حتى يكونوا مؤمنين؟ وهذا خطاب من الله إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. يا رسول الله، أيها النبي، أفأنت تكره الناس على أن يكونوا مؤمنين؟ لا، بل دعهم وشأنهم، أنت عليك ما عليك إلا البلاغ، فمن أراد أن يؤمن يؤمن، ومن أراد أن يكفر يكفر. إذن لا يمكن من خلال الآيات القرآنية المباركة ومن خلال سيرة رسول الله صلوات الله وسلامه عليه أن يكون رسول الله يمارس ولو للحظة واحدة مفردة الإرهاب، بل رسول الله هو حارب هذه المفردة، وفي ذلك الكثير الكثير في سيرته صلوات الله وسلامه عليه.
Verse number 32 of Surah Ma'idah, Surah number 5, which really highlights the Islamic position on the sanctity of life, that we find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مِنْ أَجْلِ ذَٰلِكَ كَتَبْنَا عَلَى بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ أَنَّهُ مَنْ قَتَلَ نَفْسًا بِغَيْرِ نَفْسٍ أَوْ فَسَادٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ فَكَأَنَّمَا قَتَلَ النَّاسَ جَمِيعًا وَمَنْ أَحْيَاهَا فَكَأَنَّمَا أَحْيَا النَّاسَ جَمِيعًا. That for that reason, we prescribed unto the children of Israel that whoever kills a single human being, takes away the life of a single human being without just cause, for no reason, such as spreading or causing mischief in the land, or for not having killed another human being. Anyone who takes away the life of an innocent human being, it is as if he has taken away the life of the entire humanity.
جاء الرسول صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم فنشر مبادئ السلام ونشر مبادئ المحبة ونشر مبادئ الإخاء حتى أن الله تبارك وتعالى يقول في محكم كتابه وما أرسلناك إلا رحمة للعالمين.
The reality of Islam remains under skeptical lens until today. The aggression of certain Muslims has overshadowed Islam's peaceful teachings, while the mainstream media has become the box of thoughts for our contemporary society. The truth about the Holy Prophet has remained untold. Due to the excessive attention placed upon Muslim minorities, the reality of Islam and its teachings has been devalued. Regardless, he still remains the epitome of mercy, and his name lightens the hearts of millions. His example inspires many, and his character attracts the minds of individuals from all races and backgrounds around the world.